You're watching Ashes Houston, where I make television happen.
Always be prepared. Always observe. Always look your best. I've become the most successful private investigator in the city by following these simple rules. My name, Leroy Xavier Brown. But my friends call me Goodfoot. That's because I always manage to dance my way out of tight situations, a talent necessary for survival in my line of work. Today, I was working on a very difficult project. Unfortunately, it's not the kind of project that gets a broad man paid. But that's when she walked in.
Mr. Leroy Xavier Brown.
Yes, how may I be of service?
My name is Linda Eblin. I was told you're the best PI available. Now I hope you can help me. You see, last week my husband was killed. The police have ruled his death. Thank you. The police have ruled his death a suicide. But I know my husband. He would never do such a thing. I will pay anything for you to find my husband's killer.
Mrs. Eblin, please, try to calm down. Do you know if your husband had any enemies?
No.
What was his profession?
He was a genetic engineer. Vanonovan Pharmaceuticals. This year would have marked his 9th anniversary.
Do you know of any problems he may have had at work?
No, he never really talked much about his work. I'm sorry, Mr. Brown, I know that doesn't help.
Look,
much.
Don't apologize. I mean, that's why you came here. You leave the knowing part to me, okay?
Okay.
All right, now, let's get down to business. My fee is $500 per day, plus expenses. I do the first day pro bono, which means you should go home, try to relax, and I'll call you tomorrow with what I've got. And if we require any further investigation, we'll go from there. Do we have a deal?
Deal. Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mrs. Eblin. The monotony had ended. I finally got a case of substance. And it just happened to be attached to a sister with the most beautiful smile I have ever seen. This was to be no ordinary case, which was just fine by me. Ordinary is so boring.
Hi, are you Leroy Xavier Brown?
That I am, Ms.
Travers, Nancy Travers. I'm a geneticist for Donovan Pharmaceutical Company. My research staff and I have pulled together our money to hire you, Mr. Brown. We're looking to find out who or how our boss had died. His name was Ernest Eblin.
Wait. Dr. Ernest Eblin? The genetic engineer who, let me see, died last week of what the police have ruled a suicide?
Yes. How did you know?
Well, as a PI, it's in my better interest to stay abreast of such matters.
Well, in that case, I'm sure you'll be able to help us. Ernest was the best boss that I ever had. I've known him for nearly 8 years. And I never known him to be so rash enough to take his own life. Especially when we were so close.
So close? Close to what? I mean, what are we working on?
A cure for AIDS. We were on the verge of a medical breakthrough. I mean, just in a few more years, we would have perfected the vaccine. And then this? Oh, Mr. Brown, we need your help.
Miss Travers, exactly how did he die?
Well, from the coroner's report, they said that he experimented on himself and he had overdosed on his own vaccine. His own vaccine? I'm sorry, but that's preposterous. It's ridiculous. It's an absolute insult to his profession. I just can't accept that.
Miss Travers, forgive me. But I get the feeling, primarily from the inflection in your voice, that your relationship with Dr. Eblin was more than professional.
Oh, no. We were strictly professional. I mean, we had the meeting of the minds.
With no physical activity?
None whatsoever.
She's lying. I see. Well, Miss Travers, my fee is $500 per day, plus expenses.
So you're taking the case?
I think I can squeeze you in.
Great.
I need a number where I can reach you.
I have a card here somewhere. I'm so thankful that you're taking the case. I know that my staff will be just as excited as I am. I know I have a card in here somewhere. I just apologize for pulling out all my personal items. But we did
What's this?
Excuse me? Oh.
Miss Travers, I don't know exactly what it is you're trying to pull here. I deem it a challenge that you might be skeptical of my ability as a private investigator, but I find it insulting that you would think that I would not discover the truth and that you could flat out lie to me.
Mr. Brown, I can explain.
No need to. Your affection for Dr. Eblin would not be the primary subject of this investigation, at least not at this juncture, and therefore would not be mine to disclose.
The photograph means nothing.
Fine. As long as you understand that as a private investigator, I could be called to testify in court about the facts not limited to that photograph that I uncover.
There's nothing to disclose.
Okay. But I must remain objective, Miss Travers.
Of course.
Pleasure doing business with you. Now, she was more helpful than Linda was. Of course. Linda was better to look at. But I don't understand her hesitation for not coming straight about her and Dr. Eblin. Speaking of not coming straight.
Is this the office of Leroy Xavier Brown?
Who wants to know?
I do. Word on the street is that he's the best private dick money can buy.
Excuse me?
I'm sorry for my lack of manners. I swear I do have some home training. I'm Earl Clarkson.
Please don't let him be here for the same reason.
I've come to help you find my lover's killer.
Lord, I said please.
His name was Ernest Eblin.
Damn, looks like this doctor made one too many house calls. I see. Why don't you tell me your situation?
Well, Ernie was a wonderful man. We met about 2 years ago on one of those floating casinos in Louisiana. I mean, he was an absolute gorgeous specimen of a man, walking with that tramp of a woman.
Can we cut to the chase, please?
Split in for days. Oh.
Would you please get to the good part?
Oh yeah, this is the good part. Later, he and I went skinny dipping at one of those.
Please. Just the facts, man. Let's try and concentrate on the events surrounding his death.
Well, the police had ruled his death a suicide. And I know that a man does not commit suicide 2 weeks before leaving his wife and taking his boyfriend to the Bahamas.
So he was married?
Only on paper. You see, she didn't know how to treat him right, so I turned him on to what was tight. If you ask me, I think she must have found out about me and decided that she'd much rather be a married widow than a jilted jigaboo.
Please, leave the detective work to me. Do you know if he had any enemies? Someone who would have wanted him dead?
No. My Ernie got along with everybody. He kept telling me, though, how his boss was trying to ruin his career. You see, my baby was a genetic engineer. And he didn't tell me a lot about his work, though. He didn't bring his work home. I mean, one afternoon, I decided to draw him a nice warm bath, you know?
Okay, I think I have everything I need to go ahead and start this investigation. Look, my fee is $500 a day plus expenses.
So why don't you go home, and I'll call you tomorrow if I have anything that requires further investigation. Okay?
Okay, great. Then here's my card. I own a club on the west side. You can contact me there. I am there much more so than I am at home, especially now, since it's death and all.
I understand.
I've had headaches.
I'll call you tomorrow if I have anything.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Twat. I should have charged him an extra $100 a day punk fee.
Goodfoot Brown is brought to you by Frenchies. When you can't go home, go to Frenchies. And by Burger King. If you ask us, it just tastes better. And by Houston Cellular, your wireless connection. Goodfoot Brown is produced by Fully Strapped Productions, a Houston-based film and television production company. Visit our website at www.fullystrapped.com. Three clients paying me for the same case, I figured it was time to get to work. If you want to succeed in this profession, I've got one tip for you. It helps to have strong connections with the police department, especially if that connection is your ex-girlfriend. When Helen and I were dating, she was an assistant in the county coroner's office. Now she's one of the city's leading medical examiners. Yeah, I know. So why'd I let her get away? Well, that's another story. But anyway, this is a woman who knows more about dead bodies than live ones. And I needed to know everything she knew about this Eblin incident.
Forensics, this Chin speaking. Leroy, how are you? That's good. Oh, I'm doing fine. Now stop the smooth talk right there, Goodfoot. I know this can't be a social call. What do you want?
I need a few minutes of your time.
I've got some questions about a possible murder case.
Well, I'm about to do an autopsy, so I can't really... No, my assistant is preparing the cadaver now. Well, unless you can be here within the next 15 minutes.
Is this fast enough?
Dr. Marvin?
Don't. Even try it, Xavier.
Ooh, I must be in trouble. I usually am when you call me that.
If you were planning on dropping in on such short notice, why did you even bother calling?
Well, in case you were busy.
I'm always busy.
Like, oh, give me a break. I was only being courteous. Have you ever known me not to be courteous?
Oh, no, darling. You're very courteous. Especially to that cute little siren you saw in the mini dress on the side of the road.
She was experiencing car trouble and I was only offering help.
But we were already running late.
And that was nearly 2 years ago. Look, what if that had been you stranded out there?
It wouldn't have been. I have AAA. And you have 10 minutes.
All right, listen. I need the police report on the suicide. His name is Eblin, Dr. Ernest T. Black male, early 30s. It occurred on Tuesday of last week.
Let's see, I may still have a copy of my report.
How do you find
handy.
Anything in this
oh,
place?
Oh, shut up. Here it is. Eblin, file number 003-461. Yep. Suicide. Oh, wait a minute. I remember this one. It was rather unusual.
Why is that?
Well, first, there was no signs of physical trauma, no bleeding or broken bones, nothing consistent with the distress associated with suicide, or even homicide for that matter. So I did a full spectrum blood analysis. I found out he was HIV positive.
So he had AIDS?
Not AIDS, but the AIDS antibody. But he had so many built up in his system that it appeared he was fighting fighting off some massive infection of some sort. But again, no apparent signs of disease. Well, obviously that let me know where. So I did a toxicology exam and found traces of an unknown drug. Knowing that he was employed by a pharmaceutical firm, I sent them a copy of the report, hoping that they could identify it. They faxed me this.
I mean, this all looks Greek to me.
Well, even though there's no known cure for AIDS, the infected host... Right, yet. Research has shown that the infected host can produce antibodies that do weaken and ultimately kill the virus. The problem, however, is that the body simply cannot produce enough of them fast enough before the virus completely takes over. Well, these people claim that this unknown drug is being created to simulate in the host an overproduction of these antibodies.
Enabling a person with the AIDS virus to fight it off himself.
Bingo.
So, you think he was testing this drug on himself?
Well, at first I did. But look at the results from an experiment they did on a certain group of snow monkeys with SIV.
Wait a minute, what's SIV?
Oh, it stands for simian immunodeficiency virus. It's the monkey's equivalent to HIV in humans. In 100% of these cases of monkeys with SIV, the virus was eradicated. However, 34% of them survived and gained full recovery. The other 66% died anyway because the drug was too effective.
But I don't get it. I mean, how can a drug be too effective? I mean, surely that's better than being not effective enough.
Those monkeys had so many antibodies built up that they begin to interfere with the normal functioning of their body's organs and even attack healthy cells.
Almost like a form of leukemia.
Exactly. So no self-respecting scientist would play with odds like that.
Yeah, but if you're suffering from AIDS, even presented with a slim chance of complete recovery, wouldn't you experiment with a drug like that?
Many probably would, but I don't really think he had AIDS initially. In a control group of uninfected monkeys, the death ratio was 100% within hours of their inoculation. The monkeys that were infected took several weeks to die. Dr. Eblin's blood work was more consistent with that of the control group, which leads me to believe that he became HIV positive as a result from taking the synthetic drug. Either way, it's still not quite fit for testing on humans.
Well, open and shut. Suicide.
Yeah, it definitely seems that way. But there are still too many details that bother me.
Such as?
Well, first there's no suicide note. Now, I'm not trying to undermine our investigating team, but that would be the first thing I look for in a case like this. Secondly, as you will observe in these photos right here, there's a number of defensive wounds on his arm that would suggest the struggle took place. Falling down a flight of stairs, which was stated in the report, would have caused a great deal more damage. But then again, I'm just the medical examiner, not the first officer, nor the primary investigator on the scene.
So you think that someone else may have injected him with this super synthetic drug, and that he was just trying to defend himself from the attackers?
Actually, yes. But I didn't have enough time to further my examination. I was getting so much pressure from upstairs to close this case, I had to rule it a suicide based on the available evidence. But personally, I think it was a professional job. Here, look at this. There, you see? There's a precise bruise on his solar plexus. As you may very well know, this is one of the prime targets of professionals wishing to quickly subdue their opponents without leaving any mess or trace. Here, I'll show you.
You know, Helen, you really don't have to go through this. I seem to remember you being a fourth or fifth degree in something.
Washiru, come on, don't you trust me?
Oh, sure I do. But this is starting to look awfully familiar.
Aw, baby, but that was nearly 2 years ago. Now, the solar plexus is a nerve cluster located right there. It's relatively small in area size, but its makeup is so complex that a simple... And that's simply from the wrist. For demonstrational purposes, of course.
Of course.
Wow, a full-blown attack to that sensitive little area would leave the victim incapacitated.
Not only that, but it could hurt him pretty bad, too. What's this final photo of?
That's the site of the injection. See the swollen area?
Okay, question. Let's say you're diabetic, and you were going to administer an insulin shot into your arm. Which hand would you use?
What?
With which hand would you hold the syringe?
My right hand, of course.
Because you're right-handed, right?
So what's your point?
I noticed a tan line from a watch on his left arm. I'm willing to bet you he's also right-handed.
Leroy, I wish I could say I knew he was.
Now look at the other photo. You see? The site of the injection in the other photo was also in his right arm. Now, if he is indeed right-handed, would he not have naturally used his left hand?
That would suggest that there was another person involved. And after collapsing his lung with that sternum blow I just showed you, the assailant administered the injection to make it look like Dr. Eblin had committed suicide.
Bingo.
Of course, how could I have missed that?
Well, not everyone can be as sharp as Goodfoot Brown. But don't worry. I won't tell anyone. We'll just say you owe me one.
Dr. Chin, you're needed in the lab.
Thank you. I'm on my way. Don't get cocky, Xavier. This is still inconclusive. But I'll change the cause of death to undetermined, even though the chief will chew me out.
I'll tell you what. You give me 24 hours. I'll get you proof, and I'll help you close this case. And then afterward, you can take me to dinner.
I beg your pardon.
You don't have to beg me for anything, but you're so cute when you do. I'd love to stay and chat, but I've got a case to solve. And you've got a restaurant to select. Now remember, I expect my women to be perfumed and pretty.
Leroy, I...
You're such a charmer. You really shouldn't keep your assistants waiting, though. That could set a bad example.
I did not.
Good old Helen.
Good
as beautiful as ever and just as abrasive. She answered a lot of my questions, but now the answers have given rise to more questions, the biggest of which being, working under the assumption that Dr. Eblin did not kill himself, who would want to jack someone who's on the verge of creating a cure for one of the deadliest diseases known to mankind? Why couldn't this be a simple adultery case? Good PI always goes back to the crime scene. Cops always manage to miss something.
Mr. Brown, please, come in.
Thank you.
Right this way. So can I offer you something to drink?
No, thank you.
Okay. Have a seat.
Thank you.
So, what have you found?
Well, I got the medical examiner to review your case. Mm-hmm. We both feel like it was murder, but we've yet to find any proof.
My...
I just need to ask you a few questions to confirm the police reports.
Okay.
That is, if I'm not interrupting anything.
No, I was just finishing up my workout. Go ahead.
According to police, you arrived at 11 o'clock p.m., found the door locked. Upon entering, you found your husband lying at the bottom of the stairs.
Yes, at first I thought he may have fallen down the stairs, so I phoned for an ambulance. After he died, the hospital told me it wasn't from the fall, but... that he had overdosed on some exotic drug he was working on. They even found the syringe in his pocket. I couldn't believe it.
Yes, you were right not to believe it. Do you know what time he got home?
Around 6 o'clock, without fail.
Were you here when he arrived?
No. After work, I went to the mall and then to the grocery store.
So that would leave a window of about 5 hours. Do you mind if I have a look around?
Of course not. Go right ahead.
Who's the martial artist?
I am. I teach class at a dojo on FM 1960.
I feel safer already. Tell me, Mrs. Eblin, have you moved anything since that night?
No. The housekeeper comes in once a week, and she won't be in until Saturday.
Does she have her own key, or do you let her in?
No, I'm always here to let her in.
You know, I never asked what your profession is.
I'm a buyer for African imports.
and a part-time student.
What are you studying?
I'm pursuing my MBA.
That's interesting. None of these boards seem to be loose. At least nothing obvious that would cause an uncontrollable fall. Unless there were poor soles on the shoes he was wearing. Nonetheless, if I'm falling down a flight of stairs, I would find something to grab hold of. But I don't see how your husband could have done so without disturbing the immaculate condition of your stairs. Mrs. Eblin, are you sure there's nothing unusual that took place in the days just prior to your husband's death?
Well, I recall that he argued over the phone with his boss a lot.
What sort of arguments?
Heated debates. Something about FDA approval. There may be something in his files. I cleaned out his desk today.
Do you mind if I take a look at them?
Of course not.
Thank you.
Wait! The drawstring is broken. It'll make the whole thing fall on you. Let me get that for you. A new railing was one of the things I was shopping for that night.
Thank you.
Do you mind if I take a quick shower?
Oh, no, not at all. Go ahead.
It won't take long. In the meantime, make yourself at home.
Might think that detective work is glamorous. They watch shows with guys driving Ferraris, wearing long trench coats, carrying shiny 45s, and think that all we do is live a life of action and adventure. Well, this is the heart and soul of being a detective. Meticulous sifting of facts and details, hoping you reach pay dirt. Well, well, well. Looks like I found it. Houston's choice for afternoon jazz is KFSP. Strap it on.
Did you find anything interesting?
This scene is also featured in many private detective shows. The femme fatale. Unfortunately, it is very true to life. And that can spell danger if I don't remain focused. I never want to make it a habit of getting emotionally involved with the client, even one like Linda. Now, I gotta quickly figure out a way to excuse myself. I swear, it's tough being me sometimes.
You don't have more questions for me?
Ooh, she's not making this easy at all. Actually, I have one more question. Your husband, was he right-handed, left-handed, or ambidextrous?
He was right-handed only.
Thank you. That eyeshadow that you're wearing compliments your eyes in the best possible way. What color is it?
Midnight blue.
Thank you very much for your help. I better leave now before I change my mind. Don't move. Goodfoot Brown will be right back. Hey, this is Brown. Thanks for tuning in to my new show on Access Houston. I'm starting to really get burnt out with the clues of my latest case. I could really use a hint. If you think you have it all wrapped up, hit me on my tip line. I'll check my messages during the next program break. If you're right, you could win some really cool gear like a Goodfoot Brown cap or a t-shirt. You and a friend could even be selected to make a guest appearance with me in a future episode of Goodfoot Brown. Just pick up the phone and call 713-523-7649 to leave your name, address, age, and daytime phone number along with what you think the answer to the mystery is. There's no charge for the call. Now, if you can't get to a phone but still want to enter the contest, drop me a postcard at P.O. Box 14053, Houston, 77221. Or log in at www.fullystrapped.com. We now return to more Goodfoot Brown. That letter I found was from Dr. Eblin to the FDA, with his recommendation to reject his own cure. It seems he didn't agree with what his company was planning to do with this miracle drug. I now have a suspect with a motive. But before I go after the suspect, I have to completely rule out suicide or misadventure. Fortunately, I can do it all in one place.
Mr. Brown, thank you again for coming.
Actually, Ms. Travers, I came here to ask you a favor.
Anything.
I want you to set up a meeting with Mr. Donovan. I have a few questions to ask him.
Sure, I'll do that for you.
Well, I can't give you too many details of my investigation, but I do believe Dr. Eblin was murdered. However, I do have to rule out the possibility of suicide or, as the police would say, misadventure.
Misadventure? What do you mean?
I mean, quite possibly, Dr. Eblin could have killed himself accidentally through his own experimentation.
That's impossible. Ernest was a strict professional.
I agree. I mean, he was always checking and rechecking his calculations.
I'm just trying to touch all of the bases. I mean, the police think that he experimented on himself because he had AIDS. Now, as a result of the vaccine that you faxed to the coroner's office, they now believe he got HIV as a result of taking the vaccine.
Yes, that's correct. A person inoculated with the vaccine would indeed test positive for the AIDS antibody, but show no apparent signs of the disease. You see, the vaccine is designed to signal the body to respond as if it were being invaded by the AIDS virus, but by a number of the 10 times the amount of the normal invasion. As a result, the body produces more antibodies in response to this massive infection.
But when the body belongs to a healthy individual, there are no infectious viruses that these rapidly producing antibodies attack. And worse yet, nothing to keep them in check.
So the antibodies begin attacking the healthy cells of the body. The person eventually dies.
In how much time?
Usually 6 hours or less.
But there's no way that Dr. Eblin could have been conducting regular experimentation on himself without any of us knowing about it.
Wait a minute, let's be objective here. He certainly could have smuggled a few syringes and hidden other records of any outside experimentation.
But I've already seen what his wife had collected today when she came to clean out his office. There is no journal or record book of any sort.
So if this were an isolated case, that would leave suicide.
That's absurd, I tell you.
Look, I sympathize, but if I'm going to pursue a murder suspect, I've got to rule out all these things first. Now, do any of you remember anything in Dr. Eblin's behavior and mood changes before he died?
No.
I mean, was he under any strain from work or home?
Well, he could have had some trouble at home.
Why do you say that?
Well, a few days before he died, his wife came to see him, which was strange because she never visits. I remember wondering who she was because I've never seen her before. So I thought I offered to help her find where she was going. But she said she didn't need help, so I paid her no mind. Until after she stepped into Dr. Eblin's office and closed the door. That's when the fireworks began.
What do you mean by fireworks?
Well, I'm not talking about your midday conjugal visit, that's for sure.
I mean, they really got into a heated verbal exchange. I think she upset him by showing up unannounced. Dr. Eblin was the type not to make this work with his home life. I mean, we all knew he was married, but he didn't even have pictures of her anywhere. So naturally, we didn't know who she was.
What happened next?
Well, she stormed out and the doctor called after her. Dr. Eblin must be really ticked because I can only imagine how embarrassed I would be. And it wasn't until this morning when she came to claim his possessions that I saw her again. She wasn't too social then either.
Can you recall what they were arguing about?
Not specifically, but I think she suspected him of infidelity.
Was there anything to substantiate her claim?
No, but like I said, Dr. Eblin kept his private and professional life separate.
What about arguments with his boss?
That's nothing. They fight all the time.
And that was normal?
Well, they both needed each other. Dr. Eblin needed Mr. Donovan to fund his research, and Mr. Donovan, knowing how close Dr. Eblin was to a cure, was in line to receive a lot of money because of it.
let alone the possibility of having a Nobel Prize recipient on his staff, think about the notoriety Donovan Pharmaceuticals would receive.
Okay, so it was a marriage of power. But did any of you know that Dr. Eblin was about to send a letter to the FDA to recommend delaying the approval of the vaccine for another 3 years?
No.
Then everything suggests a suicide. According to the police report, there were no signs of a forced entry, no trauma, nothing to suggest that they were tied down or subdued. In fact, there was nothing to suggest any significant damage other than an injection wound on his right arm. What? What is it?
Are you sure the injection wound was in his arm?
Yeah, I mean, I have the crime report to prove it.
That doesn't make sense at all.
Mr. Brown, I can explain. A concentrated dosage is too potent to be taken in the arm. When you were a child and you had gone to get your shots for the measles, mumps, and rubella, did your doctor give you the shot in the arm or in your hip?
In the hip, why?
That's because the medicine's too strong. If you're shot in the arm, it would be so sore you could barely move it. And if Ernie, Dr. Eblin, were to inject himself, he too would have done so in the hip. Here we are. This is Dr. Eblin's office. I'm going to leave you while I speak with Mr. Donovan.
Thank you.
Listen, about earlier, I know you don't have to keep covering for me. I just want you to know I appreciate it.
Like you said, there's nothing to disclose. I love detective work. The constant checking and rechecking of facts, ruling out anything that is contradictory. There's a smooth logic behind it that people just don't understand. Have here. Maybe he did do it. My God, this isn't an experimental journal. It's his personal diary.
Mr. Donovan's ready to see you now.
Yes, Senator. I'm saying you should vote against those automobile political action groups. I just think there's a better use for oil and petroleum than wasting it in people's vehicles. Yes, like pharmaceuticals and plastics. Well, listen, Phil. I gotta run. Talk to you later. Mr. Brown, have a seat. Would you like some candy?
Thank you.
That'll be all now, Joshua. So you're looking for Ernie's killer. Do you have any suspects?
Yes. You?
Oh, really? You certainly get to the point, don't you, Mr. Brown?
Did you threaten to ruin Dr. Eblin's career?
Like I do every week when he's running slow and behind.
Were you pushing him to move so fast that he proposed a dangerous drug for FDA approval? Now, you know Dr. Eblin was not going to let you do that.
I don't need FDA approval. There's so many loopholes, anyhow. Probably working in my advantage. And right now, I have a vaccine that can cure one-third of the AIDS-infected community. Worldwide. For a dying man, one out of three chance is worth the gamble. Either way, I'll make money.
But what about your conscience?
Having a conscience is expensive. I got rid of mine with my tax attorney well over 20 years ago.
And what about the prestige that your company would receive from an FDA nod?
Do you have any idea how they dragged their feet? How long it would take going through all that protocol? Just would take too much time.
And let me guess, time is money.
But of course. And you're about to file bankruptcy.
Dr. Eblin was costing you millions in delays. Now that he's gone, you can easily find another hotshot geneticist to take his place.
Just what are you implying?
You hired someone to bump off Dr. Eblin, then covered it up for fear of embarrassment and questions from the press.
And how did you think I did that?
You are a man of influence.
I have a few friends, yes.
Well, I have a friend who's close to this case who says that they received pressure from upstairs to close this case, whether it had an accurate cause of death or not.
You're right. I did put a lid on this case, but only because that idiot's suicide was an embarrassment to this firm.
Suicide?
Yes, which leads me to my second point. Why would I have someone killed if it would come back to me?
Well, that I haven't figured out just yet.
It's been a pleasure meeting you, Mr. Brown.
Well, I suppose that means I'm off your Valentine's Day list.
Come in here and escort our guest from the premises. This is totally ridiculous. I can't believe this guy is accusing me of this.
Lighten up, Goliath. I know my way out.
Ray, bring me a cup of coffee. I can't believe this guy's accusing me of this mess.
That Mr. Donovan is as slick as they come. For every question, he had an answer. Problem is, they were good answers. My allegations would never stand up in court. This diary is a lucky break. If there's any evidence against Donovan, it's in here. Maybe old Ernest is trying to help me from beyond the grave. Well, this looks interesting. It appears there was trouble in Dr. Eblin's marriage. According to his writing, he is tired of his wife's mood swings. And this part corroborates Harold Clarkson's story about the doctor leaving his wife and taking him to the Bahamas. Mood swings might make anyone a bit crazy, but nothing would make me leave Linda Eblin for Earl Clarkson. Wait a minute, what's this? Some sort of stain. Mr. Donovan was more eager to put his drug on the market than he let on. Eblin was going to eventually scrap his research. Apparently, he projected that at best, the vaccine could offer only a 75% rate of recovery. And being the perfectionist that he was, the cure would have to be closer to 100% or nothing. Just the thing that would piss off money-grubbing Donovan. Ruining Eblin's career simply would not be enough satisfaction for him. In fact, this last entry mentions that Mr. Donovan threatened to ruin more than his career, but his life. That's good enough for me. Not only do I have a suspected motive, but now I've got opportunity. Not to mention written testimony from the victim himself. I'll show this to Helen tomorrow and then have it admitted as evidence. But before it gets too late, I've got just one more client to follow up on.
Hello? Oh, yes, Mr. Brown. What's up? Yes, why don't we meet at my club later on tonight? Oh, yes, it's my club. Oh, no. That's all right. I'll put you on my private guest list.
Actually, I was hoping for a more intimate setting where I could ask you a few questions about the...
Well, Mr. Brown, if I'd have known you were coming at me like that, I would have jumped a little sooner. It just so happens that I have a private executive room in the back of my club. So if you and I could...
No. You're misunderstanding me. I meant somewhat else.
We'll stop and discuss a few particulars
about the case. Remember
the case? I'm sorry, Mr. Brown, but someone's knocking at my door. Maybe we'll meet later on tonight. Okay? Bye-bye.
Damn! I do not want to go to that punk-ass club.
Just a second!
Case 99% sealed up. There was only one other thing to do. Collect.
Hello?
Yes, Mrs. Eblin. This is Mr. Brown.
Oh, Mr. Brown. No, you didn't catch me at a bad time. No, I'm in my car. I knew I was going to be out this evening, so I had my home phone forwarded to my cell phone.
The wave of technology. What will they think of next? I've about got your mystery solved for you.
You think you found the killer? That's great. Mr. Donovan, who would have guessed?
What was that?
I just passed by the big Catholic church on Main Street. I just can't believe it's already 9:30. Listen, will you come by tomorrow?
What time? Good. I'll see you tomorrow.
$5.
$5? I thought it was $3.
Look, you was here last week. You know it's $5. Get yourself in that club. Hey, how you doing? Oh, wait a minute. Where do you think you're going?
Inside.
We have a dress code here.
What are you talking about? I'm wearing shoes, slacks, and a shirt.
Yeah, I know. And you are overdressed. See, we don't allow straights in this club. We've already had too many bashings.
I see. Earl didn't mention that little fact over the phone. But a good PI is always prepared.
Well, welcome to Twat. I'm Biggie Draws. You look awfully familiar. Have we met before?
In your dreams, fish.
You better go on with your bad self. Hey, girl.
Earl is wearing a black sequins dress with matching shoes and matching earrings from Drags and Rags on the 69th block of Rochester. It's last year.
Man, I feel like I'm trapped in a bad episode of Springer.
Well, that's going to do it for our evening gown
conversation. Gin and juice. Easy on the gym.
Got it.
Do you enjoy working here?
Security, man.
Next is our first competition.
I'll bet.
And our first contestant.
I'm looking for Earl Clarkson. Has he arrived yet?
Nah, he's not here yet, man. Usually he'd have been here an hour ago.
Well, when he arrives, you tell him Leroy Brown is looking for him.
Will do.
Appreciate it. Ma'am, I didn't order this.
It's compliments of those gentlemen.
I hate this. I really hate this. See, this is exactly the reason why I should have charged him an extra $200 a day punk fee.
Hey,
What's going on, Godiva Chocolate? How you be? How you be?
Hi. Ooh, hamburger. We haven't seen you in here before. What is your name?
My friends call me Goodfoot.
What your foot good at?
Dancing.
I know that ain't all.
I'm game. You want to go dance?
Not right now. I'm waiting for a friend.
What he good at?
Damn. Ain't he some serious?
Excuse me, y'all.
Let me show you how a real lady should do it. First lady class, okay?
Jeez, these guys can't even burp like real men. Well, just let me demonstrate how this game is played.
Mr. Goodfoot.
Okay.
What? Wait a minute, sister. Let me tell it.
Speak now.
Are you sure that you're gay?
Of course. Why?
Because either you got a tight throat or your friend.
Okay.
You see how that do.
Now that'll keep. Hmm.
A good P.I. thinks fast on his feet, and right now, it was time to do the Goodfoot sidestep.
Girl, I don't know who he think he fooling.
You guys got me all wrong.
No,
I don't do the job. Mm-hmm. I get the job done to me.
Hard.
That was close. I almost had my cover blown. No pun intended.
Okay.
But now, it's time to perform the Goodfoot Shuffle.
There's my date.
You okay, sister? Come on.
Gay, all right?
Look, I'm looking for Earl Clarkson. Do you know where he is?
No. I don't give a damn who Earl Clarkson is, okay? Because you're gonna be my new bitch.
That's fine. As long as I get to be.
That's what I'm talking about.
The one that gets on top.
Okay.
Ooh.
Well, I'll be damned. It worked.
Lost your damn mind coming up in here trying to be butch. Now I gotta show you what my foot good is.
You gonna hit me, girl? Girl, whoop his ass. Whoop his ass. Girl, come on.
I managed to escape from Betty and Wilma, but I better pay Dino a visit. find out what may have happened to him. What happened?
Trauma to the base of the cranium, rapid hemorrhaging. My guess, he never saw his attacker.
Were there any witnesses?
No, not yet. No one heard anything. No signs of forced entry, so robbery wasn't a motive. Just a random senseless act.
Ashes Houston, where I make television happen.
Hey, this is Brown. Thanks for tuning in to my new show on Access Houston. I'm starting to really get burned out with the clues in my latest case. I could really use a hint. If you think you have it all wrapped up, hit me on my tip line. I'll check my messages during the next program break. If you're right, you could win some really cool gear like a Goodfoot Brown cap or t-shirt. You and a friend could even be selected to make a guest appearance with me in a future episode of Goodfoot Brown. Just pick up the phone and call 713-523-7649 to leave your name, address, age, and daytime phone number along with what you think the answer to the mystery is. There's no charge for the call. Now, if you can't get to a phone but still want to enter the contest, drop me a postcard at P.O. Box 14053, Houston, 77221, or log in at www.fullystrapped.com. Goodfoot Brown is produced by Fully Strapped Productions, a Houston-based film and television production company. Visit our website at www.fullystrapped.com. We now return to more Goodfoot Brown. I was up with the police until nearly midnight. I answered all their questions, gave them the details of my investigation. Now they want the diary as evidence before they arrest Donovan. I told them I'd bring it to them first thing in the morning. It seems I've created an airtight case against Donovan. But if that's true, why was I tossing and turning all night?
You're early, Xavier. By the way, congratulations on solving your case. I assume you're here to see the report on your client who died last night.
No, but I am interested. He was my client.
The cause of death was massive internal injuries.
What was the murder weapon?
There was not one found on the scene. I don't think there was ever one involved. In fact, it looks like the same professional job that was done on Dr. Eblin last week.
I mean, how can you tell?
The assailant delivers a blow to the ribs, collapsing a lung and rupturing the spleen. He then kicks his knee, snapping it like a toothpick. The victim goes down. Now with his head exposed, the assailant follows through with a massive blow to the base of the skull. Spinal fluid collects in the cranium, causing massive pressure on the brain. The client never had a chance to defend himself. Perhaps you've seen enough. This is obviously not the reason why you're up with the chickens. Leroy, what's wrong?
I'm sorry, Helen. It's this diary. I mean, I found it the other day when I was looking through Dr. Eplin's office. I mean, there's some pretty heavy stuff in here. The bringing to trial and ultimate conviction of Mr. Donovan will be supported only by my relinquishing it to the police.
So what's the problem?
I want you to look at this page under the microscope.
What do you hope to find?
I'm curious about these ink smudges here at the bottom of the page.
Is that it?
In the meantime, I need to use your computer.
Would you like for me to pick up your dry cleaning also?
Like a scientist, collecting facts is essential to my work. But sometimes, you gotta say, to hell with it, and go with your instincts. Right now, I was playing a hunch with nothing to go on, but, of course, it wouldn't be the first time.
Yes.
but I didn't have enough time to further my examination. I was getting so much pressure from upstairs to close this case.
Having a conscience is expensive. I got rid of mine with my tax attorney well over 20 years ago.
From the fall, but that he had overdosed on some exotic drug he was working on.
So sore you could barely move it. And if Ernie, Dr. Eblin, were to inject himself, he too would have done so in the hip.
I found where she was going, but she said she didn't need help, so I paid her no mind.
If you ask me, I think she must have found out about me.
Here's the blow-up of the page you were curious about. You know, those aren't ink smudges. The ink was diffused into the fibers of the paper as if though it were exposed to water. The smudges were actually created by some bluish residue on the paper that doesn't even match the ink. That's all I can tell you without further analysis. Hey, now, where are you going?
To clear an innocent man's name.
What? You mean Donovan didn't do it after all? Hey, you're supposed to leave that diary with me. Good, but that's evidence.
Mr. Brown, so nice to see you again. The police have told me the good news. They're going to arrest Frank Donovan for my husband's murder. I can't thank you enough for your help.
Well, they're not going to arrest him just yet. You see, I have the crucial evidence with me. The police are waiting for me to turn it in.
Well, why haven't you? If you're waiting for your payment, I can just write
you
a check.
That's okay. I just have a few more questions to ask you. You know, routine stuff.
Won't you sit down?
I prefer to stand.
Ask away.
Were you and your husband having marital problems?
What do you mean?
Let me rephrase the question. Did you know your husband was having an affair?
Well, I had always suspected. He never paid much attention to me.
Did you confront him about your suspicions?
No.
They say you and your husband were arguing at his office a few days prior to his death.
No marriage is perfect, Mr. Brown. We all have our problems. But that doesn't mean I didn't love my husband.
I believe you. You know, the evidence they're going to use to convict Mr. Donovan is this diary. Were you aware of its existence at any time before your husband's death?
Of course not.
I see. You know, he writes about the vaccine, the marriage, his affairs. Very personal stuff.
Just what are you inferring, Mr. Brown?
I just find it strange. Over and over, I've been told how Dr. Eblin kept his private life and professional life separate. But yet, find his very private diary at his very professional office.
Well, you just said he was having an affair. Perhaps he didn't want me to find his diary.
I doubt that. You know what else I find very strange, Mrs. Eblin? Why would Mr. Donovan kill your husband? I mean, surely he was worth more alive than dead. Yes, he was costing him millions of dollars. But in a few years, he was going to provide him with a cure for AIDS with a better than 75% success rate. And to kill him. And to link the murder back to his firm. And to kill your husband's lover before I get a chance to ask any questions.
Look, I don't care about the reasonings of a maniac or what happens to my husband's faggot friend.
Ah. How did you know your husband was having a homosexual
you
affair?
You just said he was having an affair.
I told you he had a lover. I didn't tell you he had a gay lover. That's twice now you've lied to me.
Just what did you come here for, Mr. Brown? Am I now a suspect? Do you think I killed my husband?
It has crossed my mind, yes.
Why in the hell would I do that?
Why, indeed. I was at the police station today to drop off this diary, and I decided to play a hunch. Life insurance companies don't pay survivor benefits until they have an official copy of a document from the police department determining the cause of death in unnatural cases. When I looked up your name, I saw this form. Bankhead Insurance. Name, Linda Eblin. Deceased, Ernest Eblin. Relationship, spouse. Cause of death, pending. Amount, $1 million.
This is ridiculous.
Ridiculous? How ridiculous is this? You found your husband's diary. You found out he was going to leave you. You confront him at work. You argue. You storm out feeling betrayed. You remember the animosity between he and his boss. You figure that this is a way for you to get even. You take the syringe and vaccine. You hire someone to kill him, using the vaccine to implicate Donovan. But what you don't figure is that Donovan and his clout will use his political influence to close the case and avoid embarrassment. His death would be ruled a suicide. Insurance companies don't pay for suicides. You hire me to put all the pieces together for you. You planned the diary near his desk, knowing full well that I'd find it. I'd reopen the case, Donovan would be arrested, and you would collect a cool million in vengeance money. What a smooth plan. But what I don't understand is, why kill Earl Clarkson?
To confuse the issue, Mr. Brown. I didn't want to make things too easy for you.
Well, your plan probably would have worked, except for one major flaw.
What's that?
You hired me.
Oh. I don't know about that, Mr. Brown. Intelligent men have always turned me on. That's why I married one. And you know, Mr. Brown, $1 million can buy us an awful lot of condoms.
Sorry, lady, but you're poison. Like the song says, never trust a big butt and a smile. We'll just wait here for the police.
Now look who's talking major flaws. Just how are you going to prove I knew about the diary in the first place? You have no motive.
Well, that's right. I didn't tell you how I knew. You knew about the diary. Well, you see, I got thinking about how much of a perfectionist your husband was. It showed in everything. It led to the FDA. Even his threat to stop his research because he couldn't achieve a 100% success rate. Even in his diary. Each page carefully handwritten. Written in 1 week intervals. Every page perfect. Except for one. This one. This page outlines his affairs. You see how the smudge is examined by an expert. Their tears with residue. Residue from an eyeliner. Midnight blue eyeliner. I did believe you when you said you loved your husband. You cried. You cried when you found out he was cheating on you.
And why shouldn't I be upset? If he didn't want to be married to me, fine. But to have an affair with another man behind my back was totally humiliating. He had no right to do that to me, no right at all. Damn him! I deserve that money after what he did to me.
You're right. He had no right to do that to you. But you had no right to have somebody kill him and then have another man take the blame.
You think you've got it all figured out, don't you, Mr. Brown? You've got it all, except you're wrong about one little thing.
Oh, and what's that?
I didn't hire anyone to kill Ernest or his boyfriend. I did it myself. You know, Mr. Brown, you really gave me my money's worth. It's really too bad, you know. Things could have really turned out nicer between us.
So I guess it's curtains for me, huh? Stay right there. We'll be back with more Goodfoot Brown. We now return to more Goodfoot Brown.
In today's news, a bizarre tale of murder between a wife and her husband. 27-year-old Linda Eblin was arrested for the murder of her 32-year-old husband and his 25-year-old lover. Eblin will be arraigned on Thursday. If convicted, she could face life in prison. You will recall from a previous story that her husband, Dr. Ernest,
this turned out to be a simple adultery case after all. That brings about another mental note. Be careful what you wish for in a case. You just might get it.
Gonna be like this.